my co-convener, Holly Hughes. Pleasure to welcome you all here tonight. Thank you so much for coming. We're so thrilled by this incredible turnout tonight. So many people that I'd like to thank for making this event possible. First and foremost, I want to thank Hilary Ballard, the Deputy Vice Chancellor of NYU Abu Dhabi, for having invited me to organize this event. To celebrate the publication of the book that Holly and I co-edited and published recently. And then to Hilary for putting the Institute's many resources at our disposal in terms of the financial and logistical planning for this event. The person I want to thank next is the queen of those logistics, and that's Kate Benuska, who has just been brilliant organizational skills and calm guidance and wisdom have really served us well as we try to pull together a bunch of crazy theater people and all the songs. At one point, actually, Kate sent me an email, like a warning email, but she did this her typically mild-mannered, calm terms, and she wrote, "Yuna, in my experience, having 8 people on stage makes it hard to have an orderly conversation." Because being orderly was not high on Holly and my list of priorities. So here we all 8 of us, and Kate helped us figure out how to get up here. And so I want to thank you so much, Kate, as well as the other members of your team, Gillian Johnson, Alison Junger, and Eric and Andrew, who are the tech people tonight. Another group I want to thank most profusely are my colleagues in the Animal Studies Initiative, especially our fearless leader, Dale Jameson. In his new jacket from Shanghai. Yeah. Dale's leadership, the animal studies program, is really thriving, and that includes our minor in animal studies, one of the first in the country, our visiting scholars program, which we've hosted some fantastic people, our new postdoc, and I'm very happy to welcome Nicolas Delon. And as well as a whole series of very fantastic events and conferences, including one we're going to be doing in the spring on digital animals. I also wanted to thank you, Dale, and also thank you to the wonderful ASI staff, Jonathan Connors and Amanda Punju. Finally, I want to thank, well, I'm supposed to be talking into this for downstairs.
Not so many.
No, okay.
I'll let you
know. You need to start talking. Okay. It's all right, okay. So finally, perfect at this moment, I want to thank and warmly welcome the fabulous group of people on stage. I won't introduce them individually. You have their bios in the program, and we've worked out a little system for self-introductions when we start talking. But I do want to say how happy and proud I am to share the stage with them, and also how happy and proud Holly and I are to have them in our book. The book, which is entitled Animal Acts, Performing Species Today, was published by University of Michigan Press earlier this year. And of course it has many more contributors, and we're sorry we weren't able to include more of them because that would have been really disorderly. Alas, too expensive. So our ambition for this event is to continue something that the book is dedicated to, which is to generate and create a conversation between the fields of animal studies on the one hand and theater and performance studies on the other hand. And also to create a conversation or a dialogue between theory and practice. So it's our hope today that we're going to somehow move seamlessly, although in a very disorderly fashion, back and forth between discussion and performance, between showing and telling, acting and thinking, whatever, all our favorite binaries, sleeping and waking. To make all this seamless disorder work, we happen to have the world's best MC, and so I'm just thrilled to be able to turn the evening over to her. She's going to tell you how, what we planned and how this is going to go. And so please welcome, for the evening, our MC, the one and only Carmelita Tropicana. Woo!
Home to bed tonight, and that is this book. I will ask you. You will not be counting sheep because this is too exciting a book. And we work like dogs. And I am happy as a lark to share with you. I'm not crazy like a loon, no. All right, I'll stop. Welcome you all, and it's a wonderful to see all of you. There's some luminaries in the audience. My God, Kate Forsting, Peggy Shaw, oh my God, Lois Weaver, David Kerr, so many more. So many more, in so little time. So I just want to say that this is going to happen just like Una said, it's going to be like a Quaker meeting. It is as the animal spirit moves. So I don't know, this is like a jazz thing. I don't know who goes when or how or why. I am hoping, Dave, that you know they will go on. So without further ado, I want to say that, you know, the first question, and you know, we can talk about it, you know, everybody can, instead of me saying who each one is, I'm not going to say that this is Dick Weaver. This one over here, because it would be wrong. So each one is going to introduce themselves, and they're going to say, you know, how the subject of animals has opened up in their practice as a performer or as an academic. To me, it has made me a better person. It has made me a better dresser. And it has given me compassion. And with that, maybe I turn it over, please. Maybe.
What's the question?
That is the question. Say your name and talk about how the natural subject has opened you. Open up. Open.
It doesn't open anymore. I need a little warning, but there was going to be an opening. I am so delighted to be here tonight. It was wonderful to work with Una and to work with all of the artists and scholars. Great to be here. You know, it's due by the book. I guess you're not supposed to keep saying that, but but it's worth the price of the book just for the cover, the back and the front. I mean, it, unfortunately not in scratch and sniff, but and what's inside is very good as well. But working on animal studies in some ways came very naturally to me and feels continuous with being a noted infamous homosexual, because I come from that moment in lesbian history when the community was divided into a couple of groups, into the dog people, the cat people, and the asthmatics. Our community is so accepting and open to people with allergies. We love people with inhalers. We're the most embracing. But if you did the line, or then there's people people that go both ways. And if you weren't, you know, I mean, you didn't have to have a dog or a cat. We could barely pay our own rent. So, but you had to like sort of align. I remember telling friends of mine who didn't line up with one of these signs, and to just tell people you're asthmatic, you're never going to get laid. So there was a certain kind of continuity in some ways. And I also feel like, as someone who went back to the Midwest after escaping, much like Dorothy, getting to the Emerald City and then going back to black and white in Kansas and losing the fabulous shoes, and became a crazy dog people, that I noticed that it's a queer love. It's really a queer love. I love the wrong thing too much. I have too many of them, you know. You know, I'm not monogamous. I don't just have one cat. You know, it's like you get one animal and then other things can happen. So I feel like there's a certain kind of continuity between the work I was doing. Nobody, like, really in Ann Arbor would talk about gay people. I mean, maybe they would, other than me, in the kind of way that they talk about, you know, crazy cat and dog people and how many dogs and cats I have and all of that sort of stuff. So there's a certain kind of continuity. Thank you. And I turn it over to the fabulous Dean Weaver.
Real Dean Weaver.
Okay. I'm doing a project that is called The Unreliable Bestiary, and I'm doing a performance for every letter of the alphabet, each letter represented by an endangered species. But the reason I guess I started is because before that I was just, most of the things I would do would have animals in it. So once upon a time there was a fuzzy little puppy. He was the fuzziest puppy in the whole wide world. He was fuzzy, fuzzy, fuzzy. Now one day, this puppy met a kitty. The kitty was very fuzzy too. The puppy thought to himself, my goodness, that kitty is almost as fuzzy as I am. What I would give to meet the fuzzy kitty. Oh, the fun we'd have being fuzzy together. We'd hold paws. We'd go for a walk in the park and stand in the rain and look up into the clouds together. We'd drink coffee. We'd stay up late and eat popcorn and watch the movies. We'd invite our friends to come over for dinner. We'd have elaborate meals and fancy wine, and they would drink and dance and laugh and sing about how happy they were and how fuzzy we are. All asleep with smiles on our fuzzy faces. I must meet this kitty. I must make her acquaintance, or I may live to regret my reticence. So the puppy spoke with urgency. Hail and well met! To whom do I have the pleasure of speaking? For surely, you must be the fuzziest of all the world's kitties. Fuzzy kitty smiled ruefully to herself. Gentle fuzzy puppy. Stay your tongue and flee while you may. You look upon peril itself. My star is darkened with sorrow. My fate, a short ride off a tall, steep cliff. Save yourself. I am not what I appear. Yeah. Oh, well, look, I may not be the sharpest tool in the shed, but I don't see how you could be anything but a delightful fuzzy kitty, said the confused fuzzy puppy. Alas, I wish it were so simple. As a younger kitty, I had such hopes, so many, many dreams. But then one night, forgive me, I cannot speak of it. Hark, the hour goes late, the sun sets. Save me, fuzzy puppy, I am undead! Kitty, where are you going? Hey, come on, look, I'm a couple sandwiches short of a picnic. I got problems too. Let's work it out. But his words were drowned by thunder, lightning, darkness. The fuzzy kitty began to glow in yellowish green. Her fuzziness sprouted coarse tufts and unsightly mats. Her eyes popped, her teeth snaggled, her back hunched. Her skin began to ripple and roll with what must have been a pack of angry beavers fighting to get out. Convulsing, moaning, jerking, locked in a terrible inner battle, Fuzzy Kitty managed to drag from her lips, "Fuzzy Poppy, I love you! Cannot save you! Fly, you fool! Fly!" And she was lost. Her eyes froze, her lips clamped tight with a cold, hard snap. With a sudden piercing gale, the clouds blew free of the moon, revealing the kitty to have turned into an 8-foot-tall demon cat. Fuzzy Puppy said to himself, "My kitty is a demon cat. But wait, what's this? Some flying speck, growing larger, flying with terrible speed, blocking the light of the moon, eating the darkness with its ghastly tusks. A great winged vampire pig, flown from hell to suck my blood, eat my soul, and boss my darling kitty around like, make her get them drinks and bar snacks and whatnot. Huge, ugly pig, hovering over my poor, deformed kitty. He's sniffing her. Then vampire pig speaks, "This hell cat stinks of love. I hate love. Run, mother kitty, run! Vampire pig whirls on me, stinks of fat tusks into my fuzzy neck. But before he can drink my precious blood, fuzzy kitty bites my arm, pig in the butt, betrayal, minion from below, and attack from the ranks of his minions. This will not stand, roared vampire pig. He opened his huge, ugly mouth and God, he bit the head off my fuzzy kitty. No! 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 No!
Myself. So I'm really looking at the...
Want to talk a little bit about how animals have influenced your theory, or the theory has influenced your animal?
Sure.
Oh, she's a great singer, but I don't know whether she has a song for.
What an act of ballroom. And actually, what was amazing, the moment we were screaming, I do that in class all the time, so I think some of my students here are going to attest to that. I think it's the best way to communicate theory. In little ways. I don't think of myself as doing animal studies proper, but maybe that's the actual way to be here in relation to animal studies, because there's something quite improper about it. I mean, one of the things that animal studies does as a way of as an interdisciplinary field is to break down boundaries that have been naturalized, the boundaries between the human and the non-human, in ways that I hope, and certainly in my own work, that open up new spaces for thinking ethics and new spaces for thinking relations between humans and their environment, both the so-called natural environment and that environment the humans continue to affect. And I, in a strange way, I should say that I'm not exactly what you call a dog person. I can go both ways. I mean, some of my best friends know dogs, for example. I'm more of a cat person of long duration. If you're my Facebook friend, you will understand that my cats run me. They get a lot of likes, and I just sort of ride in their cattails. Thank you, Helen. But I have recently gone a bit to the dogs, and strangely I've gone to the dogs via Freud, who has much to answer for, as he always has. But I am someone who thinks that psychoanalysis is a way to think about the social, or particularly to think about the question of witnessing to trauma. And I'm reminded of actually this quote that's been long attributed to Freud, and his daughter Anna recounts it for us. Freud was a big lover of dogs, and his beloved chows, and his last years of his life, he also had a Pekingese named Jumbo, which is a huge name for a very tiny dog. His family got him Jumbo. It's actually a very poignant story. Freud and his family had to flee Vienna after the annexation, the forcible annexation of Austria by Germany. And he was very lucky, he and his family, to get out of Vienna. Four of his sisters would die in camps. Freud predeceased their own horrible death in camps, so he did not know the fate that awaited them. He was helped out of Vienna and to England by Marie Bonaparte, who also was a lover of chows. They bonded around chows. So dogs actually were some of the currency. There was a great exchange of chow puppies among Freud and his friends and also with his patients. So they had this very important role, actually, in the history of psychoanalysis. And I'm really interested in thinking about the role of the dog in the analytic session, Freud's Chow Yofi sit in the session, much to the annoyance of some of his patients. Because what Freud would do is that when Yofi would move, he put the time's up. The dog, basically the tick-tock of the dog, right? Yofi knows time's up, so everybody comes up. And we have, you know, records of patients grumbling about this Yofi, that maybe a chow looks at you, but time's up. When Freud went to London with his family, at this point, they had another chow, Loon, who had to go into quarantine because of England has the rabies, and they quarantine animals for a great period of time, 4 days. And so Freud, you know, in the papers announcing Freud's arrival in London, they also talked about just how heartbroken Freud was that he couldn't have Loon with him. And he'd go and visit Loon in the place where Loon was confined until the quarantine was over. So Freud's family got him this Pekingese named Jumbo in a hope, as Anna Freud tells us, that this dog could somehow compensate for this loss. And Anna Freud says, it didn't quite. But we have these families, movies from Freud's in which poor Jumbo just tried so hard to replace Moon, and is walking, you know, Freud at this point is ailing, he would die of jaw cancer not so long after the exile to London. We see this footage, this amazing footage of Jumbo just following Freud around the yard, including sort of over the threshold with him. It's this beautiful image. But Freud had, you know, he wrote profoundly about ambivalence, the ambivalence that characterizes all human love relations, the love and the hate that are intermixed, even that such that we don't even always know that intermixture. Although, of course, I bet some of you in this room might sometimes be aware of the fact that you hate people you love. Because you're all of you well analyzed because you're like in New York City, right? But this is one of the lines of Freud that brought me to dogs, and to think about what does it mean to take seriously the relationality between the human and the non-human. And he said of dogs, I'm not sure if I agree with this, but the dog people in the room can tell me. He said, quote, dogs love their friends and bite their enemies, quite unlike people who are incapable of pure love and always have to mix love and hate in their object relations. So Freud attributed to dogs, and I would say Freud had some failings. I'm a queer theorist, so I can point out some of those failings when it comes to talking about gender and sexuality. He also is very useful in thinking about both. But he didn't like cats. That's one of his failings. But he's here attributing to dogs, actually, an ability to be absolutely unambivalent in their relationship to humans and to other dogs. They just let you know how they're feeling. This was Freud's interpretation. Again, I don't know if he's accurate. But what this gives a picture of, I think, is Freud's own yearning for a relation that would in fact not be ambivalent, for a kind of radical honesty. And one of the actually very pointed things we know about Freud's last days, again, he suffered for many, many years with jaw cancer. He would die in September 1939. And during the last weeks of his life, he knew he was dying. And one of the ways he was dying was that Moon would no longer go into the Freud's sick room, would no longer join him beside the bed because the smell of Freud's jaw, rotting jaw, was so powerful that Loon knew Freud was dying. So, and one of the things that's amazing to me about this is that in the end, Loon gave Freud the radical honesty that Freud asked for, which was the bracing recognition of mortality.
Ways, because the same thing happened to me, but with cats. Now I like the pussy very much, the cats. Is the spirit moving that way or this way? Which way is the spirit moving?
On the cat.
Okay.
So I think it's my turn.
All right. Okay, let's hear it.
Hi everyone, I'm Erika Rundle. I'm not a performer, I'm a professor. And I have this kind of like semi-scholarly, semi-intelligent list of things that I was being told of to kind of like figure out what we were going to say, and I wrote it all down, but now I'm throwing it out because I'm so inspired. And I commented on Joseph Keckler's piece, Cat Lady, for the book. And so I'm going to invite Joseph, I'm going to tell a number of anecdotes, and I'm going to invite you at the moment that you feel you should kind of chime in and maybe sing something.
Yay! Woo! Woo!
So I'm a cat lady, and I'm proud of it. I was proud of it. I was actually raised by cats in the woods, as a matter of fact. And you know, so whenever I see a cat on the street, like I say, oh, I want to meet this new cat, and a lot of first dates have gone very wrong. And I talk to the cat on the street instead. But when Yuna invited me to comment on Joseph Keckler's piece, Cat Lady, I was so excited because it was the first time that I could actually write about cats and think about cats in my scholarly life.
They both work.
Okay. So So when you invited me to write about Cat Lady, I was so excited because I thought this huge part of my identity that I had kind of been keeping under wraps could actually become part of my scholarly life. And it was really a turning point for me. I had been interested in animal studies and was primarily kind of writing about primates and genre and performance and theatricality. But then I started writing about cats, and since then I've written two more articles about cats, and now I can't stop. But one of the great things about Joseph's piece is that he kind of characterizes his mother as a witch, and I got very interested in this connection between witches and cats. And I had this kind of revelation while I was working on the piece that cat ladies are like the kind of contemporary domestic tamed version of witches, right? So I decided to teach this course on the history of witchcraft. And it just happened that I had 12 other students plus me, which was 13, and so we constituted ourselves as a coven. I teach at a women's college, so it was kind of like, you know, I'm shocked nobody did this before. So I decided I was really going to push that scholarly envelope, and I decided that I was going to bring my cat with me to class. Now, I have a number of cats, but the one who's kind of the most sociable and mobile is named Grey Malkin, which is the name of the witch's cat in Macbeth. I think the line is, I come, Grey Malkin, I fly, right? So my cat is gray, and it is named Grey Malkin, and I would bring my cat to class, and sometimes my cat would hang out in my office, and, you know, other people bring their dogs to work. It's like a very kind of accepted thing at Mount Holyoke, so I thought, I'm bringing my cat to work. I don't care how weird that is, my cat's gonna hang out in my office. I have a little litter box in my office. And, you know, my office hours would roll around and people would knock on the door and I'd be like, oh, you know, do you need help with your paper? And they'd say, is Gray here? I'd like to come see Gray. So she became a really popular cat and she was kind of running down the halls with a shot at midnight, you know, with her belly kind of going. And so I was so excited to teach it again, and then over the summer, I got this email from the Mount Holyoke kind of powers that be, and they said, we've instituted this new rule, this new policy. No more domestic animals in the classrooms in the office. After decades and decades of having them, right, one person brings a cat, and like the entire thing is done. I was so upset about that. So I decided that I would teach another course where we would go around the campus and look at all of the different animals that were at Mount Holyoke, because I'm on the third floor of this building. In the basement, there are all kinds of laboratory animals. There are chameleons and mice and rabbits and snakes and toads and insects. Lots of animals are in the basement of the building that I'm in, but it's okay for them to be there. So I thought I would kind of investigate this by bringing my students to a biology professor's lab who happened to have a bunch of chameleons. And I was kind of thinking like, all right, this is this interesting kind of interdisciplinary moment, because that's what performance studies and critical animal studies and gender studies, which I also do, they're all interdisciplinary. So this is like my moment to kind of connect with this biology professor. And I'm going to go in with the idea of adaptation. That adaptation is connected to theatricality and camouflage and masks. And we're going to talk about chameleons and actors and the kind of history of acting and anti-theatrical pressures and all of that. So we walk in to the chameleon lab. And a professor, who I will not name, to protect him, said, we walk in and he says, hi, I'm Professor so-and-so, and I kill animals. That's what I do.
No.
They smiled.
No.
So it was really fascinating. I had to switch my kind of interdisciplinary mojo thing really, really quickly. And we spent that kind of session talking about what is the anti-theatrical prejudice. Right? What is the history of this fear that you're not human? Right, actors are always kind of characterized as like subhuman or superhuman, right? So I've been kind of toying with this idea all along that, you know, actors are very close to this animal self. Artists are very close to this animal self, and that makes them incredibly threatening. And many theorists of acting have tried to understand, what is this thing we do called acting? Is it an animal spirit that kind of spontaneously comes out of people? What is this? So the chameleons were there for our entire, you know, analytical discussion about this. And the biology professor looked kind of mildly interested. And then at the end, he said, so what we do with the chameleons is we're trying to understand their like muscle locomotion and how they kind of propel themselves into different environments and then how they change. And we're looking at the way that they leap, and we have them leap into kind of different environments, and we look at what they do. And then we get that data. And you know, we crunch those numbers, and then we do all of those same things again after we've got off their tail. So my students were a bit aghast. But I have to say that I'm now committed to this kind of interdisciplinary work. Right? This stuff was happening on the basement of my building. Interesting, the kind of stratification of it, right? The animal experimentation is in the basement, and the kind of cats and dogs, you know. The Shakespearean cats and dogs are up on the third floor running free, not anymore. So I just decided this is a kind of great interdisciplinary moment. My college also happens to be trying to remain viable as the first women's college in the United States. We're having trouble staying open. And so there's all of this pressure to consolidate departments, specifically interdisciplinary departments. So disciplines are really kind of crucial questions, I think, to think about species. And so with that, Joseph, I want to welcome you.
I like Erika's commentary on my piece better than like my piece. I like to carry it around. Before I had the book, I liked to carry it around in a bag for commentary. You know, if I ever was in a bad mood, get it out, have some laughs. So, we're going to visit my chameleon lab. This is on, or it's kind of okay. We'll just do a couple. I'll do a couple things. I'm just gonna. Animals have opened my practice up to page 55.
I am not a cat lady,
my mother declares. A bag of whiskas under her arm and a mane coon at her feet. She marches through the laundry room to answer the lament of a portly calico who is kept locked in the pantry.
No, you stay out here, Don Diego.
She cautions the mane.
Mrs. Gummidge has yet to reconcile herself to other cats. Thus she remains in self-imposed exile here in the pantry.
My mother manages to slip into Gummidge's chamber without Don Diego.
Well, Gummidge, you didn't finish your white albacore. Why didn't Gummidge finish her white albacore, pray tell?
She directs the question to the calico while referring to her in the third person, the way in Batman Alfred speaks to Bruce Wayne.
Master Wayne wishes not to entertain any guests this evening.
Gummidge desires that I take this tiresome tuna away and present her in its stead with some fresh whiskers. Or perhaps some science diet. Gummidge needs a new schnick.
She moves from butler talk to baby talk.
Gummidge finished with get to me.
My mother emerges from the pantry.
the china plate of abandoned albacore in one hand, the now slightly lighter package of whiskers in the other. She is wearing a calf-length pink cotton skirt and a discarded t-shirt of my brother's that bears down the front the word paranoia 6 times. Her hair hangs down to the middle of her back, though it is gradually becoming more and more white. For years it was a deep copper, with just 2 silver streaks that framed her face. The streaks have been a lineament of her icon in my childhood. Several of my classmates have believed her to be a witch, citing the strange strands of silver, symbols of age that stood in contrast to her still youthful face. My mother has some wrinkles now, but her lips remain overly full, defiantly young. Only months ago, a Walmart one-hour photo clerk mistook her for my wife. She is an aged chameleon. Sit down, Carol, she says to my aunt, the sister of my father, who waits for her in the kitchen. I'm just going to run upstairs and quickly change. Take your time. My mother is usually an obsessive hostess, assaulting guests with hot chocolate and pillows, items of sustenance and comfort. But Carol comes over almost every day now. She is slender, with recently bleached blonde hair and red lipstick. She had once embarked on a Broadway career, but aborted it, opting to marry and raise a family. Still, she is revered by community theater goers throughout the greater Kalamazoo area. Her husband, Jerry, recently had an affair with an amateur country western singer named Debbie. He is now divorcing Carol. She has taken to self-medication, frequently preparing cocktails of vodka and various anti-anxiety pills. My mother returns in a purple skirt with intricate black designs, a luminous gold short-sleeved shirt, and alligator boots. Want to visit Gummidge? She asks. Oh, not right now, kid, Carol replies. In a bit, though, I'll see plenty of her. Carol has agreed to help my mother take Mrs. Gummidge to the vets this afternoon. She's awfully forlorn, you know. A one-time filmmaker, poet, mixed-media artist, and high school English teacher, my mother has not created work since our house burned down in 1986, destroying her reels, assemblages, and manuscripts. Since that time, she has, however, devoted herself to the 24-hour-a-day interactive performance installation of caring for, integrating herself into, taking over, and dramatizing the lives of cats. While critics, historians, neighbors, and the mailman all classify this piece as quintessential theater of the cat lady, my mother often entitles it, "I am not a cat." This may be understood as a surrealist strategy. Akin to that which McGreed employs in his painting of the pipe, accompanied by a caption which reads, "This is not a pipe." Or perhaps "I am not a cat lady" is in line with the philosophical-religious texts of Simone Weil, who asserted that the contradiction is the test of reality. My mother, the cat lady who is not, wishes to keep her relationship to the cats unexplained, to create a void, a momentary evacuation of meaning where something unpredictable might happen. A vacancy could be created, and God might show up to fill it. Who knows? So that's a little bit of then I thought, you know, just to touch on artist and actress and chameleon and witch, and I could just line them up and knock them down there. So I just kept going. Maybe I'll just keep going right now for briefly, not too long, but I think, you know, once I'll just do it and be done, you know. So now we can. They're both kind of like just prop mics, but I just want this one. Can you just turn it up, not for me, but for my friend, who is my mom, my real mom. Her voice does sound different.
Is it alcohol?
We're just a couple of cuddles.
This is on my voice.
I just needed to bring my other passion for horses into my scholarship, and amazingly, performance studies and American studies allowed me to do that. And I one time crossed from scholar into performer because I wanted to use material objects and embodied experience, not just reading an academic paper, to talk about how my own personal and family history with horses could open up a wider understanding of horses in the past. And when I was invited to give a talk on this, and I thought there was going to be a black box theater there, and I thought, well, maybe I'll just, you know, bring my saddle. And, you know, the way that leather absorbs the oils of the bodies that move together. So I shared this idea with my partner, who happens to be on the acting and directing faculty in Iowa, and she said, well, are you going to do it in riding clothes? And what about a horse? So suddenly I found myself in riding clothes. I made a horse out of objects in our basement with power tools. Which I keep with my John Deere tractor mower. Place in Iowa. And I made this piece, my goodness, I did this piece and at a conference, and who should be in the audience but Holly Hughes, who invited me to accompany her on this dog and pony show, and I found myself on a bill with Joseph Keckler and Deep Weaver and Holly and Carmelita and these other amazing performers in the book, and not only on a bill, but in a dressing room with Holly and Carmelita. So, you know, how has this opened up my practice? Here I am from Iowa and NYU and Abu Dhabi. I find it setting itself above and apart from the animal kingdom, the most powerful people, i.e. the white men, the leaders had to ride horses. And, you know, when you see them in all of these monumental sculptures, and there are a number in this city that are part of this tradition, there's one of General Washington around here somewhere, you know, they all look very poised and in control as they sit there on their well-hung horses. I challenge you, and I've been through a number of European capitals and have done this myself, to find an equestrian statue that does not have a well-hung assembly, regardless of whether the rider, you know, was on a mare or a gelding, which we know that they were from other records. But at any rate, the point is they look secure, in control, and they look very manly. Well, contrast that with what actually happens when you ride, and, you know, the flesh on flesh, the sweat. You are melding with this huge animal through the nether regions of the body, and that this was actually a very troubling, and I would argue very queering phenomenon that these powerful people in Western history covered up, just how troubling and queering it was through the long durée of horsepower, millennia of intimate congress with horses. So I want to uncover those troubling aspects. And performance has given me a way to do that as both an object and a method of study.
Private experience, private lives, and theory, consideration, policy, you know, larger developments of these disciplines. There's something almost indecent about animals or animal studies, and you're talking about your pets, you're talking about these creatures you sort of sleep with at night. And the opportunity to talk about them and take them seriously feels to me like a kind of explosive move within the academy. The book that actually got me into this field, there were two. One was Steve Baker's wonderful art history survey called The Postmodern Animal. But the other one was J.M. Coetzee's novella, Lives of the Animals, which is about a novelist, maybe an artist, trying to talk about animals seriously and literally, not metaphorically, not symbolically, but really talk about the lives of real animals in a university. And the real difficulty of doing that, of incurring some of the history of a kind of rationalism, which tends to push aside background or marginalize or trivialize, infantilize this relation, the relation we're about to have with it. The other thing, of course, is that it is as one of you was saying, but there's a kind of animal theatricality. That theatricality feels like a human-animal function, which we certainly saw. I think that's one of the things Deke was exploring in that piece, is that you let the animal in and you let excess in. You let that excess become possible. You kind of always go, that moment where you start screaming and then wouldn't stop, screaming more and more and more. That's so distinctive and characteristic of animal performance. It always opens some door, which then just kind of catapults you, as it were, out further and further. So I just feel that we've, in a way, performed that in our different things this evening. I guess I turn back to you, and we get the audience started.
I want to acknowledge Josh Chambers Letson over there drinking that water. Everybody turn and look at him. Because he contributed to the book, but he actually talked about it. Well, in the book he wrote about bees. Do you have any that you want to contribute to us?
No.
Okay. Well, we've got to acknowledge.
Some of the bees are dying. Yeah.
I know.
We should take a moment for the bees.
So, do people have questions or comments or
cat songs?
Anything you want to share? Anybody? No.
Well, can I just ask?
Oh, wait. Somebody's asking.
I'm interested in hearing the panel talk about co-presence of humans and animals within theatrical events. Animals are so present, right? They're so present, and as performers, that's what we're always trying to be, is present, but animals just do it. So that's about as articulate as I can be. I'm just going to put it out there, and does anyone have any comments or responses to that?
I think I do have one thing to say. It may not be directly to your point, but one of the questions we were going to talk about was whether we in our work in animal studies had encountered recurring challenges or assumptions or problems. And one of the ones that I had thought about, which comes up for me all the time, is the difficulty for people of distinguishing between literal animals and actual animals. And by that I mean that what animal studies, as I see it, is dedicated to, is to take animals seriously first. In other words, to think of them as having lives, species, lives of their own, which are extraordinarily complex and so on. And in doing that, it's a departure from the history of animal discourse, especially in literature, which is to make them metaphors, to make them into symbols, and to make them the figurative animals, which basically are stand-ins for ourselves. So the thing that animal studies does is to talk about animals as beings, literal animals. That doesn't mean that, for example, with theater, that must involve actual animal bodies. In fact, one of the things I talk about in the introductions, almost none of our the performances in our book involve bringing live animals onto the stage. These are all performances that are deeply considering the actual human-animal relationships, and not purely in a symbolic way, but as those are lives that we co-live on this planet with these other species. So yes, the question of presence is, you know, and many of us, certainly Holly and Kim, have based their performance on the actual interactions with actual animals. In Holly's case, it's in the agility world, the sport of agility, and of course with Kim, it's writing. So those are based on that, but in the performance, the presence is the presence of taking animals seriously and not disappearing them into metaphor.
But for me, it was a problem when I first started the conquest of Mexico. I seen through the eyes of Fernando Cortez's horse, because everybody goes, oh my God, she's trying to make fun of things. So sometimes humor, it's a problem. It's, it just undercuts, you know, the seriousness of the event. And people really look down on it. It's like, oh my God, what is she doing? So sometimes there is that balancing act of, you know, what you're trying to say. And history did. Was the thing that really, to me, brought me over to begin the animal studies. And then it went through sci-fi and hybrids and woman bears and that kind of a situation. And then you could do gender. I thought she was butch, but no, she was a woman bear.
Has been a liability for both for animal studies and for environmental studies and ecocriticism.
Yes.
And I think one of the exciting things that's happening in both these fields right now is the investigation of you know, new and other affective registers and different genres and styles with which to approach what is an incredibly complex subject and problem. In other words, you know, not to simply be pedagogical, serious, and mournful about ecological issues, but also playful and angry and funny and you know, all those other kinds of things. So I think that this kind of performance is sort of crucial for opening up that discussion.
I was just going to add in terms of co-presence that there's a way in which I found myself kind of co-authoring with the horse, because yes, I'm writing about horses and I'm performing in a piece about that, but while I was rehearsing, I was also going out and riding my horse. So, and that's itself a performance. So there was kind of a feedback loop going on between my actual riding and then the work on the performance.
You're writing and you're writing.
Exactly. Yes. Which, you know, which is, for me, that's the best of combinations. So I became, of course, more conscious because of performing of things about my writing that I hadn't thought of, and vice versa, taking the writing into the stage work. I mean, among other things, it forced me to think with my body. I totally had to get out of my head in order to work this through. And it was such an intricate process that at ATHA, when I accepted an award for the article that I wrote about that piece as performance as research, I felt I had to thank my horse, in addition to my director and Holly, my super Liz Brasario, who got me. in my teens and 20s in my former life. So this horse was born in 1989 as I was finishing my PhD. I didn't ride for almost 23 years. This horse had his own competitive career and then was returned to my family when I got tenure and decided I wanted to ride again in middle age. So he came back to me, this retiree, but a veteran of a sport that was devised to train and test horses for the cavalry. So this horse carried within his body, his training, his life, not only the breeding that my family had developed, but his own physical experience, his own trials and tribulations. So that was tremendously powerful for me. You know, he's not just any lovable horse. He was a horse with a particular history. And now I'm researching the use of horses on stage in the aftermath of the Civil War, when both equine and human veterans were still alive. And some of those veteran horses were used on stage in plays about the Civil War. So that those embodied histories are brought viscerally to life.
I just wanted to respond to your question as you had framed it, thinking about human actors, right, and animal actors on stage and this idea of presence. And it strikes me that so many actor training protocols are really about kind of shedding the human mask and accessing a sensory animal self. So that really the project is to join that other animal on stage and to kind of meet it there. And so I think we often think of non-human animals on stage as the exception, like, oh, they brought a horse on stage, or, you know, oh, that mouse ran across the stage. Whoa, that was a mistake, right? But I think if we think of the human mask as a kind of interloper into an ecology, that's in a way of interrupting a humanist understanding of theater and performance, right? That it's really an opportunity for us to understand the human as mask, the human role as a mask. There was a book that came out recently called Post-Humanist Shakespeare's, and in the conclusion to that book, you know, one of the things they say is, you know, we have never been human. Piggybacking on the we have never been modern kind of claim. And so I think that it's really fruitful for us as critical animal theorists to think of the human itself as a mask rather than a kind of entity that is not.
Well, I was an undergraduate at NYU at Tisch, and I was in Strasbourg with my studio, and one of our exercises was the animal exercise, and we all had to go out and find an animal to watch and come back in and do the animal and be the animal. And that process of like letting that human, the privilege of quote unquote being human, that was a very scary space to step into.
When you and I started working on this book, it was evident that there was so much work with animal imagery and not animal imagery in the symbolic sense, primarily. You know, I remember there's a great Peggy Shaw piece. I don't know which one it is. It starts out with the death of a horse. Which piece is that? The death of a horse and the daring of a horse. And and my friend David Kale in the back, who's like really written about animals, have been really important in a lot of this work, and Kate Bornstein as well. I don't want to embarrass her and make her sing her song. there was enough to do, lots of different pieces. I would say that like a challenge for me, I was very excited when I discovered that there was this field animal studies, because they, been to sort of like be in conversation with new people, and this is a long bit of passion. I remember Lois Weaver directing a show of mine, and I am not an actress. I am a performer. I am a ham.
Lois was trying to get like some level, something that looked like acting, me just like talking at people, some modulation, and we tried everything in the book, and she goes, I want you to like in this moment, think about your animals. And it was, that was what she was, you know that face you get when you're talking about, at that point I didn't even have any animals. I just carried around pictures of dogs I wanted to have. That I had married into poodles. The challenge to me, and I think Kim and I have bonded a little bit over this and some problems in animal studies, is we do stuff with animals. We train animals, and I've been in numerous animal study situations where that is just seen through a prism that I don't think is true about slavery and imposition of your will. And one of the things that's so frustrating, many things that are frustrating about that conversation, but absent in that room often are people that have had any relationship with an animal other than in an academic way. And one method of being in relationship to animals, being training, and I think Kim like beautifully described the relationship with riding, and then Joseph. So, Joseph's piece is just incredible portrait of his mother, and it could be just a showcase for his amazing gifts as a performer. But he's really taking on the idea of the cat lady, and then, as it develops, this is a very flat-footed reading that I'm sure Erika does have much more interesting things to say, but her relationship to cats enabled her to save her life. Just as I feel like in The Wizard of Oz, Dorothy attempts to save herself by saving Toto. Save herself from a life of domesticity and drudgery in a sepia tone Midwestern landscape. And of course, that can't really happen. She's forced to go back, is really what killed Judy Garland. she should have never been in Kansas or been in a movie that imagined Kansas at all. But I think that sort of role of what are the different kinds of relationships that people have had for a long time with animals that are incredibly stigmatized, even as we're sort of trying to recover animal subjectivity, think more deeply about it.
I don't know what this has to do with, but the best thing I ever saw, I didn't see the clip that played War Wars, but I saw a TED talk and they brought all the horses out, and it took years to train these like five or six people on each horse to become a horse. Mm-hmm. And it took them 10 hours a day, months and months and months and months to make the movements of a horse. It was an incredibly beautiful thing to see, the way that each person moved inside the horse and created it. So they were trained, they got trained to be horses.
Okay.
Kimberley,
do you
want
to
like?
Yeah,
go ahead.
Oh, I guess there's just a kind of undercurrent here that I find interesting is what many of you have said, is this notion of the power relationship of the theater. And I'm wondering, if we are already in a theater of animals. Like, many of you have, we've talked about the cat people and the dog people. Now, cat people, anybody who has a cat who's allowed to come and go as they please through a cat door or whatever, sometimes they'll see themselves being watched by the cat in a way that a performer is watched by an audience. And in a way, we've talked about domestic animals, but cats are kind of quasi-domestic, especially ones that are free to go. And then when you're out in the forest, I live in a wilderness kind of area, and I've been watched by wolves, and I get this feeling that I'm amusing to them, it's not just a simple thing, is this food or is this foe, But this is a curious actor, basically, in this theater of the forest. And I'm wondering if any of you have kind of worked with that we're already, you know, the power relationship has been reversed, and we're actually acting in this theater of the design of animals.
Well, in training, training animals to be a good dog trainer, you have to think a lot about, and they talk a lot about, like, how are we like dogs, and how are we not like dogs? And also, one of the things that they'll talk to you about is you're not very interesting to your dog. You know, really, there's a lot, you know, and you can never be as interesting as a dead raccoon. That's the way. Surrounded by a mandala of hot dogs. Perhaps some of the like love of the dead body and smelly meat will transfer onto you. But yes, thinking about like what is, when I'm training, they'll say, why do you think your dog is thinking right now? And you know, the really good dog trainers are really good at reading all sorts of signs, and they speak all the time. They speak in another language.
When I was doing the piece about the horse, this is 1991, and I was like, I didn't know, I mean, I'd never ridden a horse. So I went to, you know, the park to, you know, get on a horse, and the guy was, you know, like in Central Park, not Central Park, but there was a stable on 84th Street, took me, and, you know, he rode the horse, and he said, okay, you can do the same. And the horse was beautiful, absolutely beautiful, when the rider rode him. And there's like, I read a lot of stuff about the rider and the horse, how beautiful they are, you know, together they become one, and, you know, I thought, oh my God, this is wonderful, I can't wait, I get on the horse, and the horse is like this. That horse knew that this one had never in her life and had no, I mean, wouldn't be shame. But I loved it because it sort of taught me something. Like, you know.
Well, I guess I'll just add to sort of the academic side of things. It's one of the kind of privileged tropes of animal studies theory, especially in literature. The two texts, there's an early text by John Berger called Why Look at Animals, and then Derrida's very famous and influential text. And in both of them, what's at issue is this new space, this new recognition that opens up in the moment that you become aware of being seen by someone capable of seeing similar to you, the way you can see. So there's a kind of complex circuitry, but it's about that kind of recognition is easily pushed aside, forgotten. But I think one of the things that animal studies is doing, especially in its intersection with theater studies, is inviting more and more of those moments. Those moments of recognizing that you are seeing the way you see the landscape, or you know, and what that does to yourself, your sense of yourself in your species life. Mm-hmm. Lisa.
Yeah. I definitely want to say something, but I don't exactly know what. This is really fabulous. Co-presence and masks. I am a dog trainer, and I'm a good dog trainer. I take a stab at this. I'm also very interested in the work of Joseph Witowski. And let's see. I would like to pose it differently than mask, but when I'm working with a dog and for long periods of time, it's a sort of conditioning that changes. Witowski said something that I recognize as being true for me, and that is the reptilian brain, the animal brain, minus some of the conditioning. And as this happens, and the bond is gone within a very precise structure of where mutual reality is growing and mutual desires are weaving in and out, then the dog is developing some conditioning and I'm losing some. And we're meeting. In that, there is co-presence. I don't like them, whatever. And there can even be such a heightened presence. Yes, this would be like something that I would imagine, well, I don't want to imagine, but that I would think of being a great ritual to go up, up, up. You know, in joy, yes, exaltation, something there. And with that dog, with that being, high, higher, and also something about mirror neurons and the way of watching. And yes, to see the other, and the other that sees, this is interesting, but inside of the dog bond with the trainer for long periods of time inside a real structure with desire towards this and this, feeding each other, there's give and take. And there's a way of watching to give and take. And in that, if there's so much give and take and so much love, then if that dog is running like flying, then I can see and fly, and the dog will allow me to watch, but not every dog. Only that one, maybe 2 years, every day, love.
Thank you, Lisa.
Thanks,
that's it.
It was not a performance. There's the dog jumps.
Jewish philosopher who was actually interned in a camp. He was a prisoner of war, and much to his luck, and he knows it was lucky he was a prisoner of war and not imprisoned as a Jew, because then he wouldn't have survived the camp. But he has a short essay called The Name of the Dog. It's just a 3-page essay, and he's known as a philosopher of the face and the radicality of recognition. Can we see the face of the other? What does it mean to turn face of the other? He thinks through Jewish theology, so he's also thinking about a kind of transcendent face and transcendent recognition. In this really short essay, he talks about being in the camps, and for the short period of time, the prisoners are being marched off to their labor, and they're being treated brutally by the guards. And the men and women and children surrounding this camp treat these prisoners also with great disdain as less than human. And of course, part of the treatment of Jews and other prisoners of the Nazis were they were bestialized, especially the Jews. Racializing rhetoric of anti-Semitism. And he talks about this dog that came briefly into the camp and whom he and the other prisoners came to call Bobby, an exotic name, as Levinas says. And the dog would greet them when they returned from their labors, would greet them with joy, a barking of recognition rather than the ways in which the Nazis actually used dogs, which were attack dogs. And so there's this meditation of what does it mean? And he calls this dog the last Kantian in Nazi Germany. That this dog was extending this radical recognition of him as human that these humans were denying. And I mean, Levinas doesn't go all the way with this essay that we might wish him to go, which was to say the dog has the face of recognition too. I mean, there's a way in which he sees in the dog's recognition the deficiency of the human, but doesn't see what the dog as dog offers. But what the dog did give to Levinas and his fellow soldiers, the possibility that they were actually recognized and recognizable at a moment when they were actually being utterly treated like bare life, life that doesn't matter.
That's really good. I mean, I think it's one of the moments of great disappointment that in fact, Levinas went on to say, the dog doesn't have a place. I mean, he literally said that, yeah.
I think he's wrong. But.
Yes, yes, and then that's what Jerry does doing it too. But anyway, so that's those are great references for us all to follow up with. But we now have to go down. We have a little reception downstairs. We have copies of the book for those of you who'd like to buy that, and we can carry on this conversation. Thank you all so much.